This evening, we are really thrilled to have Dr. Lynn Dumenil with us. Lynn, thank you for making the journey. She will have a conversation with us, make a presentation for about 45 minutes, after which there'll be a Q&A time, and there are microphones on each side. Camille will help navigate that, and if those of you who are unable to come to the mic, just let her know and we can accommodate that. And then afterwards, there's a book signing. You'll have seen this book in the lobby, and Sean is there, able to take your credit card, and Lynn's ready to sign it. It's not too early to be making Christmas gifts. So get all that shopping done well before. Dr. Dumenil is the Robert Glass Cleland Professor of American History, Emerita, at Occidental College. She's taught at a number of distinguished institutions, including Berkeley, Whitman College, and Claremont McKenna College. She specializes in US women's history and cultural and social history since the Civil War. She's a distinguished professor, having received many honors, including being a senior Fulbright lecturer at the University of Rome and many other recognitions, which is all to say that we're in for a treat. She brings to this topic a richness which I think is going to make this experience one of real memory for us. So once again, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being here and for participating in the activities at the National World War I Museum and Memorial. I invite you back. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Lynn Dumenil.
Thank you. I'm really delighted to be here, and I wanted to thank particularly the museum for inviting me, of course, but also tell Camille Kulig how much I appreciate her organizing me. And of course, thank you for coming. When you think about it, on the surface, talking about women and war seems an odd connection, because we so usually associate war with male soldiers, with combat, with masculinity itself. So why talk about women and war? Well, for those of you who know the museum, you know that in total wars like World War I and World War II, civilians become increasingly important, and women are a part of that process. They worked in munitions factories, they served as nurses and other aides to the military machine. And much more bureaucratically than women had worked for war than in the past. It's actually tied to the nature of a modern state, a bureaucratic war, right? And this is particularly true in the United States. Women were very much involved in a wide range of activities, and their support for the war effort is in fact a part of the definition of how modern global wars were fought. So if women's role in wartime allows us to more fully understand the nature of war mobilization and the rhetoric in support of war, it also helps us to think about the role of World War I as a watershed, as an idea that somehow since the war, things changed. I got interested in this because I did a book on the 1920s, and as I did it, people kept saying, since the war, something happened. It was their marker for explaining what they felt were extraordinary changes in the 1920s. And this is particularly true for how people talked about women. It's very interesting because right before the war, Americans started talking about this new woman. She was seemingly liberated, met after the war. She was seemingly liberated in terms of politics, work, and private life, especially in terms of sexuality. And of course, this new woman, or the flapper, as you may be used to thinking about her, was a stereotype, and she really only described, to any great extent, young, white, privileged women. But even though we can argue about how liberated women may or may not have been, there's no question that among mainstream women, at least, new norms and new opportunities were expanding, and observers during the 1920s gave the war at least partial credit. According to Frederick Lewis Allen, after the war, women, quote, poured out of schools and colleges into all manners of occupation, causing, as he put it, the, quote, slackening of parental and husbandly authority, and encouraging the, quote, headlong pursuit of freedom. So admittedly, during World War I, dramatic changes did seem imminent. Militant women suffrage supporters were outraging the nation by picketing the White House. Women were taking jobs formerly thought to be exclusively appropriate for men. 25,000 women served overseas as support for the troops. Millions did highly visible work at home. But was the war really transformative? Most of the changes that observers saw in the 1920s, we can really see as early as 1910. For example, in 1910 marks a really significant upswing in women's participation in the workforce, not 1920. The teens was also extremely important in terms of women in politics. The progressive reform era saw women's heightened political involvement, and most importantly, the suffrage movement had heated up in the teens. By 1914, 11 states had already passed women's suffrage. So before the war, Americans were talking and recognizing that women were challenging conventional roles, and they were very ambivalent about this change. And another complication about this question of the impact of war on women was that many of the dramatic changes of the war, especially those concerning women getting, quote, men's jobs, disappeared at war's end, like that. So historians, myself included, don't really think that the war was that transformative. It wasn't causal. But we still need to account for observers in the 1920s' sense of social change since the war. And for that matter, we need to understand the common belief during the war that much change was effect in terms of women's roles. These beliefs suggest that the war became a marker for consciousness concerning the emergence of the new woman. So what I'm arguing here is that the war accelerated developments already underway, but specifically heightened awareness of this emerging and contested new woman. Now, my book examines a wide range of issues, much broader than I can talk about here. Women's work, their experience abroad, ethnic and racial and class divisions among women, the suffrage movement. But today I want to hone in on this question of war as a marker of change. And to do that, I want to concentrate on visual imagery during the war concerning women and war. Now, before I get into the specifics, I just want to point out that in mainstream popular culture, women of culture of color were virtually invisible in reporting about women's war mobilization. This doesn't mean they weren't there, of course. In Los Angeles, for example, Mexican American, Japanese American, and African American women were active in Red Cross auxiliaries that raised funds and provided knitted goods. When the war stimulated the great migration of African Americans to cities of the South and North, the migrants included women who found new opportunities beyond domestic and agricultural labor. But although we can find evidence of their participation, especially that of black women, the modern woman so celebrated during the war and after was in part defined by her whiteness. So my images will focus on this group. So let me turn to the images. I'm going to look at both print and film. And in print media, we see that the representation of women reflects both traditional values concerning women's proper roles and suggested the possibility for cultural and social change.
and political change too. Now, government propaganda, for the most part, followed a very conventional pattern. Posters frequently used female figures as abstract icons representing the nation and its war aims. And if you've been in the museum, you've seen many images like this, right? A beautiful woman, in this case, flanked by the United States flag or even dressed in the stars and stripes, symbolized what the nation was fighting for and often was explicitly used to encourage men to enlist. Here she's encouraging everyone to buy bonds. This reveals the way in which wartime illustrators conflated and idealized woman with the nation state. These were heroic figures, not real women, and the iconography was deeply rooted in Western European art and religious conventions. Now, there is one kind of interesting, not official poster. African Americans don't appear in government-issued posters, so they made their own. This is from a magazine, and I really can't resist it because, one, it shows how powerful that convention was of wrapping a woman in the flag to represent liberty, right? But the other thing that's really great about this one is you can see at the bottom, or if you can, I'll read it for you. It says, Made in America, and made is spelled M-A-I-D. So it's pretty witty on the part of the editor of this black newspaper to comment on the type of work that women were allowed to do. And then inside the magazine, they also said that African-American women were made, M-A-D-E, in America, meaning they were true Americans, unlike those dangerous immigrants. So this is one image that is so exceptional that it's a kind of a good counter to the rest of the things we're going to see. So I'm gonna move to some of the government posters that were issued at the time. For the most part, they follow these very conventional patterns. Posters frequently used, Posters represented actual women in these cases and encouraged them to participate in war activities, including farming in the Women's Land Army or buying Liberty Bonds or knitting socks or conserving foods. They rarely challenged ideas of women's proper place. And I think you can see that very clearly in the lovely woman in her wheatless kitchen, the lovely grandmother warm and welcoming her sons to win the war. And then the Red Cross one is, as you may well know, one of the most popular and famous posters of the war era, and it was reused during World War II as well. And many would argue that, well, this actually suggests a lot of power because the woman who's holding the soldier in her arms is enormous and it looks like a baby, right? It's the Pietà. But in fact, I would argue that yes, it does show power, but it shows women in maternal power, right? So I think it does fit with my argument that it's fairly conventional. For the most part, government-issued posters denied or ignored the claim of women activists who insisted that women war workers were, quote, the second line of defense. So on the left, you'll see a poster created by the YMCA. It's not a government poster. And it's very typical of the Y to represent women workers as being crucial to the war effort. And this is, you've got to admit, is absolutely remarkable in the way it challenges conventional notions about women. They look like they're an army, right? They're carrying heavy equipment, wrenches and the like. And it's reminding them that women are an army. They're backing our second line of defense. The only poster that I've ever found that the government issued featuring a working woman was the one on the right. And in this case, you can see that she's doing something quite conventional in terms of early 20th century. She's a secretary. She is part of the war effort. She's doing good work, but she is clearly doing something in a very conventional sort of way. Now, like government propaganda, commercial media usually portrayed women in traditional roles as well. Poignant depictions of soldiers leaving their womenfolk behind as they went off to war was a popular motif. And there were romantic pictures of soldiers and their sweethearts, like this one. I'm hitting the trail to Normandy, so kiss me goodbye, with the man and woman locked in an passionate embrace. This one was more erotically charged than most images of the sort, but nonetheless seems to me to emphasize that war is men's work. And they frame military service not just in terms of defending their country, but of also protecting their female dependents, right? So that notion of masculinity becomes very clear in this image. Now, although these images of maternal or feminine women doing their part for the war in ways that did not challenge gender roles were very evident, there were alternative representations of women in war. In particular, coverage in newspapers and magazines of women's war efforts seized upon the way in which women were breaking new ground. As one woman wrote in a 1918 magazine article, "Today she is everywhere, a Salvation Lassie, a Salvation Army lassie, serving coffee and donuts on the firing line, in the Red Cross Emergency Hospital at the front, in the munitions factory at home, filling the gaps in man-made industry everywhere." The media was absolutely fascinated by the way in which women were taking on jobs thought to be male. And I should point out that it wasn't the case that more women were working during the war, but rather that they were working in more interesting and better paid jobs. It's a shift in the nature of their work, not an expansion of their numbers. Now, to support my suggestion of how engaged the media was, I'm giving you my absolutely favorite image. This is from the Philadelphia Inquirer. It features an illustration of seven powder workers, which were munitions workers. They're in a New Jersey plant. The women are dressed in identical overalls with simple cap. Their arms are around each other, and they look boldly into the camera. Their smiles are bright and suggest delight, if not in the work that they're doing, in having their pictures taken. The very nature of a group photograph like this, moreover, reinforces a sense of shared identity among the women as the much celebrated munitions workers. The text that accompanied the image says, "The girls employed here have shown that they are not afraid of their jobs as powder makers, but go to their work with the same coolness as men." This kind of image multiplies. An Iowa newspaper offered a photograph of a pants-wearing munitions worker standing at a formidable-looking machine and explained that women workers at the Frankfurt Arsenal in New Jersey had designed the outfit that the U.S. government had then adopted for use of women working in their plants. This attention to women's working clothes is absolutely crucial. It underscores the novelty of women taking on what were formerly men's jobs. And this would persist in the war years, this would persist in the war years for most. although there were also some slight changes in costumes for women not working in industries. For example, in the past, they wore a white blouse and a dark, simple skirt. The only thing that happens during the war for that kind of clothing is the hemlines go up slightly. But for the women whose new jobs required pants, overalls, or skirted uniforms, they were really breaking dramatically with convention. Their masculinized clothes symbolized the way in which they were taking on male jobs. And women who wore uniforms, especially conductors, elevator operators, and the like, were notable in that their apparel was linked to the notion of a military uniform. This type of uniform then suggested that women's work was part of their service to the nation in times of war. They were thus an expression of citizenship. Images of the cross-dressing worker then signaled the boundary-crossing new woman. And it wasn't just that women working in factories or in railroads or in streetcars who were wearing all these uniforms. Women who served abroad as nurses, social workers, telephone operators, or volunteered at home for government or quasi-governmental agencies received extensive publicity about their uniforms. Here too, this one is a YMCA worker, the Young Men's Christian Association, created canteens at the front and hired women to run them. This is a fairly typical of the type of image that appeared in the media. And in here, what I think is interesting is that not only is she wearing her uniform and looking boldly into the camera, but she's next to an enormous military truck. And that's very common, that the images of women abroad are shown in that way. My favorite image is one that the museum has, but it's not as good as the copy that I bought for my own house. It's a little bizarre, I would admit, to have a World War I poster in your living room, but I love it, so I did. You know, it was a present to me. This one, again, remember the YWCA is not messing around in the way in which it talks about women being part of the second line of defense, and this is really quite extraordinary. The operator, the telephone operator, is in her neat uniform. She's competently at work at her switchboard, but behind her is the backdrop of a really teeming scene of uniformed men in battle. She, like the men, is clearly at the front, a message that her military uniform underlined. And I wanted to just emphasize that it's not just women abroad, but women at home, women who work for the Red Cross, who are raising funds for the Liberty Loan, who might be working various other kinds of non-governmental agencies, all had uniforms, and they were constantly being discussed in magazines and newspapers. And so this is a good example. Some of these are women abroad, but otherwise you can see you have a woman farmer, you have a driver, and the woman driver is next to the farmer, and she's very much like my lovely woman on the cover of my book. So the activities of women as wage earners, as overseas participants, and home front volunteers received their clearest expression of both citizenship and the boundary-crossing new woman in the newspaper and magazine coverage of parades, such as the Liberty Bond parades or the Red Cross ones. And these two emphasize the uniform women. I think this is a quite remarkable one. It's taking place in New York. It's a motor corps, it's a voluntary association of women, and you can see how clearly their uniforms are modeled after male uniforms of the time. This one, I think, is also particularly interesting. These are canteen workers for the National League for Women's Service, an NGO of the time. They're walking down Fifth Avenue, right? So the sort of the iconic place where you have military parades. And here these women are as part of, I think this is a Red Cross one, with the flags, their uniforms are in perfect step. I think it really illustrates my point beautifully. And for a little local color, this is women in, or young women, girls in Kansas City. These are Red Cross volunteers who are in high school, and they're being seen in their marching in their uniforms, which is very typical of Red Cross parades to have children of various sorts, and again, all in uniform. Now, a few years before the war, it was considered radical for respectable women to be in a public place like this. The suffrage movement began its parades in 1910, and they were really considered a major challenge to respectable notions of women's behavior. This bold occupation of public space then that happened during the war was an important demonstration of women's legitimacy as political actors. But it's contested. You know, there are people who are nervous about this. So I think it's really significant that women played such an important part in patriotic parades. Now, the coverage of wage-earning women or overseas workers, at-home volunteers, offers a pervasive vision of white women inhabiting space, public space, that was previously thought to be exclusively male. This transgression was generally legitimated in the context of a national crisis that literally required that women step outside convention. If not all women donned male attire or mannish uniforms or took to the street to join male citizens in parading for the national cause, many did. and their action garnered extensive publicity that offered the American public a sense, often a striking visual one, that the new woman so often debated in the years before the war had seized the war as an opportunity for challenging gender conventions in the name of patriotism. And the same kinds of thing we'll see when we switch to film. And here again, there are both images that represent conventional women and images that are challenging them. Now, not many World War I films still exist. For my research, I saw those that did exist, and then I used fan magazines, stills, motion picture distributor summaries, and the like. There were a lot of different war films. Many of them featured battles, as you might expect. But there was another genre that focused on war and the home front and domestic issues, and they were quite striking in their portrayal of women. Many of these films represented war as a means to protect women and the family, so men's role in that protective situation. But others portrayed modern women who themselves were eager to seek to battle the enemy themselves. A significant number of films, even those that featured the modern strong woman, turned on the theme of rape and assault to stress women's vulnerability. And I'm going to turn to that for a few minutes. And to get to that, I have to go back to print media for a moment. I'm sure many of you have seen some posters like this. A couple of these, I think, are in the museum. For contemporary viewers, Remember Belgium would evoke the brutal deaths of children and the rapes of women that were the subject of extensive British propaganda. Although the propaganda was undoubtedly exaggerated, wartime rape certainly did take place, and there's certainly no doubt that the American public had a perception of German soldiers as the brutish Huns. Destroy the mad, this mad brute is another good example of this. It's originally a British poster that was adapted to the American audience. This haunting image reflects more than the artist's depiction of the Germans as beasts. Its power derives in part from the pervasive American convention of depicting racial others as ape-like hulks. It specifically enjoins popular stereotypes of racial others, both immigrants and blacks, as threats to pure white womanhood, and by extension, the nation itself. In the last one, we have to dig a bit. The woman's form across the Uncle Sam's lap is the iconic representation that we talked about earlier. But here we're supposed to connect the concept of a woman's honor, in other words, her chastity, with the nation's. This visual merging of women's virtue with national honor signaled the way in which wartime representation of sexual violation symbolized the threat to both patriarchal and national power. So it's not surprising that we see this theme repeatedly in films. One of the most important ones was Hearts of the World. It's a D.W. Griffith film. You can still see it. It was from 1918. It centers on a small village in France where two young Americans, Marie and Douglas, fall in love. But their wedding plans are disrupted, to say the least, by the coming of the war. He decides to fight for France, and then the film details the brutish Huns in many different ways. The young women of the village are sexually assaulted by drunken Germans. Marie is reduced to slave labor, essentially, in a potato field. And so the poster advertising this film features that exact act, with Lillian Gish, the actress who plays Marie, being whipped by the evil German. According, Marie is also cornered by the evil German von Strom. According to photoplay, quote, he cornered her behind a locked door, chuckling, muttering vile words in German, running a lascivious hand over her arms and shoulders as he held her close. And that's the picture is from a still. And also in photoplay. The end comes when Marie escapes to the attic where she finds Douglas, who had disappeared. So this is quite a miraculous thing, happens a lot. a lot. As they await their inevitable capture, they pledge their marriage vows, and Marie extracts from Douglas his pledge that he will shoot her himself if the Germans find them. In other words, saving her literally from a fate worse than death. Mercifully, they're rescued when a secondary comedic character, Henriette, a spunky character in the film, saves them by lobbing a grenade at the Germans as they advance. So this rape threat owes a great deal to the convention of melodrama, of US melodrama, and it was certainly not unique to the war. And if you have seen the pretty vile Birth of a Nation, you know that it centers around rape of a white woman by a newly freed slave. And guess what? One of the major, the star of Birth of a Nation is Lillian Gish. The same character here, right? And so the audience makes the connections. It's very clear. War films' ubiquitous use of this theme then added an extra layer of meaning by having the rape stand what was at stake in the war. Certainly national honor, other things, but also brutality against women, the threat to the family. And that's central, one of the central ways in which propaganda was portrayed to Americans. So for men, support for the war became framed as protection for their families. This image, Hollywood's use of this rape imagery supports Allied war aims, obviously, but it also is a vehicle for reinscribing Victorian notions about women's sexual passivity and vulnerability. Now, another genre, which one historian has called the slacker film, talks about the sort of dangerous side of familial love. There are at least a dozen of these either enlistment dramas or slacker films that feature an overly protected mother who tries to keep her son from enlisting. A 1918 film, Her Boy, features a mother who alters her son's birth certificate to make him ineligible for service. According to Photoplay, the mother is a, quote, strange study in affection and unscrupulousness. One of the suggestions for how to advertise the film to distributors was to use spiders in their display. For window work, it says, use dried or artificial spiders. Now, these are stills from the film. The film no longer exists, sadly. On the left, you see the mother at the draft board. Her son is behind him, and she is trying to keep them from taking her son, right? So it's, very powerful. The only other woman in the picture is Virginia, who's on the left with the little hat, right? Well, Virginia is the one who convinces the man that he must enlist. He must defy his mother. He must be a real man. And here she is congratulating him, and you notice the mother is long gone. This is, I think, really quite interesting. She is the all-American girl. She is modern. She is the sort of representation of young modern womanhood. And it's not the mothers, but the young women in these types of films who are usually the vehicle for restoring the man's manhood, his patriotism. If mothers are portrayed as unscrupulous or as spiders, they are also presented as just overly protective. In contrast, the young women are not just young, but they're modern. They shame the men, but they themselves are often want to go fight themselves. They talk about how sorry they are that they aren't able to serve. So these are really, I think, quite significant representations of this new modern womanhood. Now, another genre is what I call, for lack of a better word, the plucky films, plucky women. In numerous war films, young women face danger and show bravery and resourcefulness. And in many cases, they even cross-dress, wearing men's clothes for at least part of the film. These brave women were not new to the film era. Of the war era, in the teen serial films that targeted mostly working class women, featured heroines who acted in unconventional ways, courting and escaping danger, showing pluck and daring do. So when we see it in World War I, it's following something that came slightly before. The most significant serial during the war is a series called Patria. It went from 1916 to 17. The vast majority of the film is lost, but like most serials of the time, they're summarized every week with photographs or images so that you know what happens, right? Film historians are interested in Patria primarily because it was a vehicle for William Randolph Hearst. And his company, he was very heavily involved in this, and it reflected his politics. It's a call for preparedness, but it features not Germany as America's potential enemy, but rather Japan, then an ally of Britain, with an assist from Mexico. And as such, it reflects the pervasive racism in the Hearst publications. This is, by the way, before the Zimmerman telegram, so it's his idea. But here I want to focus on the representation of Patria played by the famous actress Irene Castle. Week after week, Patria and Parr, her boyfriend and federal agent, conveniently, face one horrific threat after another, and Patria proves herself to be a crack shot, an ace pilot, a fearless defender of herself and others. One reviewer's breathless comment is worth repeating at length. The reviewer seems to think that Castle did her own stunts, which was pretty typical. It's long, but it's worth it. It's kind of breathless. In Patria, she's thrown from the back of a galloping horse. She dives headlong from the deck of an ocean-going steamboat and swims to a motorboat into which she climbs unassisted. She climbs the mast of a burning ship and falls with the mast into the water far below. She plunges over a waterfall into the whirlpool. She races her motor against a railroad car loaded with dynamite. She flies an airplane. She operates a machine gun and does many other things that make you gasp. But never for a moment does she lose her dainty, graceful, feminine charm. I don't think this was all in one 15-minute segment, but possibly. The emphasis on Castle's and, by extension, Patria's femininity is pervasive in the serialized versions of the plot, as well as in reviews and advertisements. Ads and reviewers comment and emphasize her gorgeous clothing, including this one. This is an elegantly tailored skirt. It's a military uniform. She's in full military garb. Her arms are outstretched and her body leans forward, which I think conveys something to the feminine power that the serial sought to convey. So she's confident and independent. At the end of the serial, the Mexican and Japanese armies invade the United States at the border. Parr, who Patria has put in charge of her army, is wounded, and so she has to come in and take charge. And as you might imagine, the invasion was repelled. The series ends with the couple committing themselves to each other and to the service of their country. These spy and detective plots, which were emerging in Patria, also appeared in feature films. None of them still exist, but all of them have, you know, scripts and other things to let us know that this is a fairly common theme in the popular film of the time. And it really does suggest a depiction of resolute women who tangle with the enemy in a number of hair-raising adventures. So I want to conclude with two films, both of which you can see if you wish. They're starring Mary Pickford, who already was a major star in the teens, beloved for her curls and her winsome performance, in which she invariably played young girls, not women. In her two war-related films, she took on a more mature persona. In Johanna Enlists, which comes out in 1918, she features a lonely young girl stuck on a farm with very strict parents. She's bored, she's miserable, and then the army camps on her father's ground. So now things are great. She's having a terrific time. She falls in love with an impressive army officer, and when he's getting ready to go abroad, she's desolate, so she steals a military uniform to try to hide in order to go with the troops. Well, she's found, of course, but the commander agrees that she can become a mascot for the unit, and you can see in the final scene, it shows the boys marching away, and Johanna is in a soldier's suit on a cannon waving the American flag. Now, so the one on the left is one of the film's advertising campaigns. The one on the right is a picture of Mary herself, and she often did show up in this military uniform. And the reason for this is that she was very much engaged in promoting the war. She adopted the 143rd Field Artillery Unit in California, and in fact, her troops are part of the film. And this connection to the military and the war effort was a significant part of her public image during the war. She appeared both with Charlie Chaplin and Douglas Fairbanks, as well as her, as well as alone to sell war bonds. She offered rousing orations, encouraging men to enlist and women to get their men to the colors. She attracted thousands of spectators and certainly became the most well-known female supporter of the war. Now, there's no reason to think that this is all about a publicity technique, but certainly her studio made the most of it, as you might imagine. In The Little American, one of the film's posters another cool piece, so I'll just go back. You've seen these, I think. They're in the museum, so if you're a regular museum person, you know them. And on the one hand, it seems to be, you know, quite extraordinary that the women are wearing uniforms. But in fact, I don't think they suggest very much about the power that comes with uniforms. These women are sexy. They're trading on their sexuality. And I would say the same thing of these pictures, the former picture of Mary Pickford as Johanna. She's not supposed to be powerful there, right? The uniform is really almost re-emphasizing her femininity. So the images that you see in Johanna are not very radical, right? Now, this is the one I was talking about a few minutes ago. This is from The Little American. And here, what the publicity department has done is turn Mary Pickford into America, into Lady Liberty. They've taken that notion of the way in which posters present the iconic Lady Liberty, and there she is, America's sweetheart, which is also during World War I when she got that name. Now, this film is fascinating. Here she plays an adult woman. There's an interesting correspondence between DeMille, the director, and producer Jesse Lasky that revealed that Lasky very specifically wanted Pickford to, quote, portray a girl in that sort of role that feminists in the country are now interested in, the kind of girl who jumps in and does a man's work when the men are at the front. Well, Mary doesn't quite do this, but she's nonetheless remarkably competent and confident. Before the war, Angela Moore is in Washington, D.C., and has two suitors, one French, Jules, one German, Carl. They both go off to fight for their respective countries, and shortly thereafter, Angela, a neutral American, sails to Europe to help her aunt in Belgium. And this film came out before the U.S. entered the war. The boat is torpedoed, and the disaster scene on the ship is specifically designed to evoke the Lusitania disaster. In the rescue boat, we get the first hint of Angela's spunkiness. She shakes her fist at the submarine commander and, holding up the flag, exclaims, "You fired on American women and children." By the time she reaches the chateau, the Germans are fast approaching. Her aunt has died, she's in charge, and her major goal initially is to try to protect her female servants, and this is a still on the left from the film. She bundles them off to the attic and faces the marauding Germans by herself. They are brutes who threaten her. A new soldier appeared, who of course, as you might imagine, is her former beau, Carl. In the dark, he almost rapes her. Once they recognize each other, she chastises him for having become part of the military machine, and together they hear the off-screen rape of a servant woman. She says to Carl, "If there's a spark of manhood in you, go and save these women." And this is the aftermath of that scene. And this is the other film, the other poster for the film. So on the one hand, you have Mary as America, Lady Liberty, and all in reds and whites and blues, right? And then you have this pastel image, straight out of a kind of Victorian representation of the passive, genteel women who are the victims of war, the silent sufferers. And that really shows the way in which the film is sort of struggling with both types of representation. Through a complex set of developments, which you'll be happy to know I'm not going to detail, Angela spies for the French, and she's encouraged by Carl, who's now sort of come to her side. He redeems himself, in other words, by his effort. They're caught, and they're facing a firing squad But Jules arrives and saves them both, but there's still a huge disaster, and it's Mary who saves Carl from death. So she, again, is quite the heroine. She's resolute in her determination to do what is right. She emerges as an independent, plucky woman who thinks nothing of going to Belgium alone in the midst of war. And when she becomes entangled in the war, she's both resourceful and brave in saving herself and the man she loves. This plucky heroine certainly signaled challenges to conventional notions about women's essentially passive role in war. They save themselves and others. They become orators. They serve as nurses abroad. More dramatically, movie heroines like Castle's Patria or Pickford's Angela challenge barriers to notions of women's conventional and respectable behavior by taking on the enemy firsthand and winning. The radical potential of this challenge, I would say, however, is constrained by the emphasis on femininity and the predictable happy ending of love and marriage. And I would also say that this persistent motif of sexual danger remained a potent reminder of women's vulnerability in the face of an evil enemy. Films hint at a provocative new woman enjoying new freedoms and independence, but ultimately convey the limits of wartime opportunities for significant changes in women's role. So in World War I print and film media, conventional images of women, especially those that feature their sexual vulnerability, coexisted with more modern representations. The juxtaposition of the two suggests the way in which the era was really suffused with tensions about the changing roles of American women. But clearly, the media recognized and provocatively pictured the potential for dramatic change in women's lives. Working women challenged men's prerogatives, never more obviously than when they donned overalls and uniforms. Parading women who took their patriotism to the street also suggested that many women were eager to move beyond the constraints of home and family to a larger arena. Many film heroines were resourceful and independent. American audiences were relentlessly exposed then to women who challenged conventions in work, in clothing, in freedom of movement, in the occupation of public space. So much so that many were convinced that the war had produced dramatic change. But despite these expectations, these ideas really, or these notions, didn't really survive the war. Suffrage certainly was expedited by the war and is a really important piece of the story. But for women workers, their job opportunities evaporated when war was ended. So too were their assumptions about women's roles in the 1920s, a lot of anxiety about women who might be challenging those. And let me just show you two images from the 1920s. On the left, this is how the U.S. Postal Service decided to portray women of the 1920s as the highly sexualized dancing flapper. And on the right, you see the It Girl, Clara Bow. She was a far cry from the war-era women of the second line of defense. So women's proper place in the war was challenged, but at the end, by the 1920s, all of the kinds of representations of challenge that featured strong, resourceful, independent women in politics and work have really sort of emerged in the sexualized imagery that we see here. And that's a whole another lecture, so I will leave you with that. Thank you.
Folks, you are welcome to come down to either mic, or you can raise your hand and I will come to you. You described how the wave of change for women began before 1914,
yes.
And I'm wondering if you can draw a relationship between the wave of immigration in the early 20th centuries and in what followed in the first and second decades.
That's a really good question. And I tend to always say that, so I have to find a different response. But it is a really good question. One of the things that I think you may be thinking about is one of the things that happens in the for women in terms of immigration is that European immigrant daughters flood the workplace, primarily in factories. And one of the things they do in the teens is become very involved in the labor movement. So they're out in the streets picketing and showing themselves as quite resourceful and independent. And the argument is that the suffrage movement, the mainstream suffrage movement, to some extent draws its parading and more radical physical activity from working class women. So I definitely think there's a link there. Does that speak to your question? Yeah, thank you. Yes.
Hi, I'm wondering about the relationship between the Russian Revolution and the world role of women, especially in 1917, 1918.
Yeah, that's another really good question. So there are a lot of different ways to talk about it. One of the things that was really exciting for people at the time and kind of scandalous is that Russian women served in uniform. It was one of them was called the Battalion of Death, and the leader of it comes to the United States and is highly touted and interviewed. There's a movie, a really, really cheesy one based on this story as well. So that's part of it, that there's something going on here, that women are not just serving as support for troops, but there's actually an example of women who are really challenging it. And it's a long, complicated story that's tied into the revolution, obviously. The thing that I really like about it is that American women journalists go to Russia. And they have to do so, it's scary. You go on the Siberian Express, you do all sorts of things. And they get there, and they then go out with the women and interview them. And so it helps to increase the publicity about that something is really afoot. And the women journalists are just really remarkable and are at the center, I would say, of the early 20th century sort of feminist movement. Two of the journalists were part of a really important New York circle of feminists, and so they just move right into the war in that way. So that you speak to some really interesting points. Did I answer enough of your question, or did you have something else in mind?
Would you give me the name of the journalist, the women journalist?
Yeah, sure. One of them is called Madeline Doty, D-O-T-Y. Another is Bessie Beatty, who went to Occidental College, B-E-A-T-T-Y. And I'm having a senior moment. Louise Bryant was married to Reed, who wrote 10 Days That Shook the World, which is, you know, the famous Beatty film, Reds. Remember that one? And my husband, who's also a historian, thinks that she wrote the book, not Reed. So there you go. There's actually a book by a woman named Julia Mickenberg, I think, on women of the revolution, Russian women. It's really great, and includes American women as well.
Hi. My mom was in the British Army in World War II, and the way she described it at the time, that after France fell, that it was kind of all hands on deck in Britain, that no matter who you were going to serve some way or somehow. And I was wondering, in World War I, was that the same in Britain? Because at the time, I think the monarchy was a little stronger, and Downton Abbey and all that kind of stuff. But there was still a nobility around, where the U.S. really didn't have a nobility that could mm-hmm. influence things mm-hmm. in such a way. We were kind of more democratic, so to speak. And I was wondering if what that effect might have had on British women during World War I.
Well, as you know, Britain is in pretty dire straits in World War I. People are losing men at a rate they never could have imagined, 20,000 in one day. And so women are really brought in by necessity into a variety of things, both at home, but also as ambulance drivers and nurses and clerical workers. The U.S. Army would not let American women, they were in the Marines and they were in the Navy, but not the Army, they wouldn't let them go abroad They hired other people, and they hired British women as secretaries in France because they, you know, so I would say that there is a real sense of urgency, but still the Brits were dragging their feet. There was a desire to, on the part of British women, to create a land army, and the government resisted and resisted until finally they had no choice. They really needed to use women in the fields in order to bring in the crops. And so it's not quite the same willingness to do it, but there's certainly a lot of it, and much more than in the United States, because the British war is much different than the American war. I sometimes feel odd when I talk about American women, for example, who go abroad, because they're acting to some extent like they're having a great time. It's like a vacation in some ways. They're excited, it's adventuresome. And part of my explanation for that is they come, they're there for a very short time, and they haven't really experienced the devastation of a war the way Europeans did. So there's real differences between American, British, and French, and German, and the like. Thank you.
Folks, Dr. Dumenil will be available in our lobby afterwards if you have more questions. So on behalf of the National World War I Museum and Memorial, thank you for coming, and another round of applause for Dr. Dumenil.